The ever-tense situation between Israeli authorities and Palestinian Arabs boiled over in December 1987 with a series of protests and riots sparked off by a road collision near the border between Israel proper and the Gaza Strip, which killed several Palestinian residents of the Jabalia refugee camp. Palestinian activists alleged it had been a deliberate attack by Israeli defense forces in retaliation for the killing of a Jewish person in Gaza, which the Israeli government obviously denied. Over the coming months, the violence would grow, with the Israeli government taking an ever harder line to try and suppress the riots. This marked the beginning of what would become known as the Intifada, or the First Intifada, which would last until the early 1990s. Also during 1987, and I don't know the exact release date, so I'm including it here, British company Games Workshop released a science fiction version of their fantasy game Warhammer. The new rulebook, entitled Warhammer 40,000 Rogue Trader, was heavily influenced by dystopian science fiction properties like Judge Dredd and Mad Max. The first edition was moderately popular in its native UK, but showed little sign of the global hit it would later become. In January, Mikhail Gorbachev's economic restructuring, Perestroika, announced in 1985, began to take effect as legislation came into force, but Soviet forces entrenched in Afghanistan were still suffering from conditions, poor supply and leadership, and incessant attacks from the Afghan Mujahideen militia. In one incident that became famous, 39 Soviet paratroopers successfully held Hill 3234 against over 250 Mujahideen over the night of the 7th to 8th of January, a rare success story that was later dramatised into a 2005 Russian film, The Ninth Company, from which this footage is taken, but it was becoming clear that Afghanistan had become the USSR's Vietnam War and there were calls to withdraw. In early February, Cold War tensions increased in the Black Sea when the American cruiser USS Yorktown was physically bumped by the Soviet frigate Bezaventny off the Crimea. The American warships were sailing in what the US deemed international waters, but the Soviet Union claimed as their territorial waters, and the Bezaventny was attempting to crowd and eventually literally push the Yorktown back over the line. The Yorktown was accompanied by the destroyer USS Caron, which received the same treatment, and both ships were damaged, though not severely. And the 1988 Winter Olympics took place in Calgary, Canada. Unlike the previous two Summer Games, which had been dogged by political boycotts, a record 57 nations attended, including debuts from Fiji, Guam, Guatemala, the Netherlands Antilles, the US Virgin Islands, and perhaps most famously, Jamaica. The Caribbean Islands' entry into the bobsled competitions inspired the 1993 movie Cool Runnings, though the film had very little to do with the actual events. Another unlikely hopeful who became something of a hero in Calgary was Britain's first ever ski jumper Michael Edwards, better known by his nickname Eddie the Eagle. Wearing thick glasses and having his luggage burst open on the carousel at Calgary Airport on arrival, he was an instant media phenomenon, though a lot of exaggerated claims like him being afraid of heights were pure fabrication. Nonetheless, he was comically out of his depth, coming last with 60.2 points against the 140.4 points of the next lowest-ranked competitor. In the aftermath of the Games, the IOC introduced what became known as the Eddie the Eagle rule to ensure a higher standard of competitor in the future. There was plenty afoot in the world of Formula One too, as restrictions around turbocharged engines tightened for 1988, boost was now restricted to 2.5 bar, down from 4 bar in 1987, and fuel tanks to 150 litres, down from 190. Atmospheric engines were subject to no limits on power or fuel beyond what the designers could achieve. Teams would be allowed to switch during the season from turbo to atmo if they wished, but not to change back. Nonetheless, most top teams opted to stay with their turbos to the bitter end. Even Ferrari, who had been planning to run a normally-aspirated V12 this year, decided on the strength of the last two races to give it a bit longer for development and continue with their current setup. McLaren and Lotus had Honda power, with new cars and engines built specially for the 1988 regulations. Arrows had managed to hang on to their Megatron-branded BMWs for one more year, Zakspeed built their own, and Azella still had those free Alfa Romeo units from 1984. Everybody else would be packing either the new Judd CV engine or the good old Ford Cosworth DFZ, except for Benetton, who got the next evolution of it, the DFR. With only five teams running turbos, the Jim Clark and Colin Chapman trophies were discontinued, leaving Jonathan Palmer and Tyrrell as the only winners of them and excellent future quiz questions, and the lower bar to entry meant there would be four new teams on the grid. Coloni, who had made two exploratory entries in 1987, and the Eurobrun, Real and Scuderia Italia teams, which meant the return of pre-qualifying to avoid overcrowding in the pit lane during the qualifying sessions. One notable absence was Brabham. Bernie Eccleston had neither managed to find a new engine supplier nor a buyer for the team and had missed the registration deadline. An extension was granted for such a historic team, but in the end Bernie was forced to admit that the team wouldn't be racing in 1988, but that it was hoped that a buyer could be found in the team return to the grid for 1989. The calendar was broadly as it had been in 1987, but the Canadian Grand Prix made a welcome return in early June, and the Mexican race moved to May to make a three-race North American tour. Giving way to compensate was the Austrian Grand Prix, a sad loss of a great track, but one which needed a lot of work to make it more suitable for modern F1. Lotus sport the coveted number one on their car for the first time since 1979, thanks to their signing of defending champion Nelson Piquet from Williams. They will be hoping that things go better than they did for them 9 years ago, and indeed better than Piquet's previous title defences in 1982 and 84, which were both plagued with car problems. This year's car is the Lotus 100T, an evolution of 1987's 99T, with updated bodywork at the nose and rear to accommodate the return to a traditional passive suspension. The active suspension system used last year hadn't made enough difference to offset its additional weight and power drain, especially given 1988's turbo engines would be some 300 horsepower down on last year's. Nelson Piquet managed to win the world title in 1987, despite only winning half as many races as his teammate, thanks to his consistency and ability to pretty much always come through and finish on the podium. Nonetheless, he'd always felt undervalued in his 2 years at Williams, a feeling shared by Honda, who were presumably at least a little influential in his move to the boys in yellow. However, there are causes for concern. Piquet's critics have noted in the past his tendency to fade into the background when not in the best car, while unbeknownst to most, he is still suffering from the after-effects of his huge shunt in Imola last year. Nakajima owes his F1 seat to Honda, and there are many who think he has no right being in the top category, pointing to several incidents, particularly in Detroit and his ramming of Derek Warwick in Mexico, as evidence. However, he didn't totally embarrass himself and has a year more experience under his belt. His seat won't be in danger if he doesn't do better this year, though, and the Lotus team will be revolving around Piquet, the same way as it's previously revolved around Senna, so Nakajima's job is just to show up and be a dutiful number two. Tyrrell's neat little DG016 chassis had done well in 1987 to win the 3.5-litre category at a canter and do reasonably in the World Championship too. There's more competition among the atmospheric cars this year, but Ken Tyrrell will be hoping that a year's extra experience with the engine will stand them in good stead. With Data General reducing their sponsorship commitments in the aftermath of the stock market crash in October, this year's chassis drops the DG to just be the 017. It's a development of last year's car for the new rules, and Jonathan Palmer continues on driving duties joined by British rookie Julian Bailey. The Good Doctor is now in his fifth full season of F1 racing and has never really had much of a chance to show his talent in a series of backmarker teams. So the 1987 Tyrrell and the Jim Clark Cup gave him the chance to show what he could do, even if it was only to be fastest of the slowest. And his battles with feisty teammate Philippe Streff were as entertaining for the crowd as they were hair-raising for Ken Tyrrell and the mechanics. With Streff on his way, Palmer will be looking to stamp his authority on the team and continue his good form to see if he can secure a top drive for 1989 and beyond. Julian Bailey was born in Woolwich in South London, but raised on the Spanish island of Menorca, where he got into karting. He returned to England at 17 and entered the Star of Tomorrow Formula Ford series, but with more crashes than success. But he managed to buy himself a Formula Ford Lola and had some minor successes before moving into F3 with first Majewick Motorsport and then Swallow Racing. But it still wasn't happening for him, so he decided to take matters into his own hands. The Racing for Britain scheme in the 1980s allowed the general public to vote for which up-and-coming driver should get their support by mailing in a card and a £1 postal order. Bailey sold his house, bought 1,000 of the cards and mailed them in with addresses out of the phone book. It worked, and by the time anyone had figured out the wheeze, he'd actually started winning races, and it was allowed to stand. He was still sleeping on friends' floors when he won the 1983 Formula Ford 2000 series, and it took until 1986 when he was able to convince family connections in Cavendish Finance to back him into F3000, where he became the first British driver to win in the Formula, which led to an offer from Ken Tyrrell, always a good talent scout. Bailey became the first of a group of young British drivers, Martin Donnelly, Johnny Herbert, Mark Blundell, Perry McCarthy and Damon Hill, collectively known as the Rat Pack, to make it to the highest level. Williams may have been the class of the field for 1986 and 87, but 1988 will be a whole new ballgame for them as they step into the world of normally aspirated cars. Their new FW12 chassis is built to house the new Judd CV V8 engine, which is an unknown quantity, though testing has looked promising, and also building on the introduction of the active suspension system in 1987, which Patrick Head and chief designer Frank Durney hope will ensure the team doesn't get left too far behind by the turbos. Nobody at the team is saying so out loud, but most pundits believe Williams will struggle this year, even with the wealth of talent at their disposal. Runner-up 2 years running, with 11 race wins across 1986 and 87, and finally a designated number one driver, but can Nigel make the most of it in 1988? The engine situation means most are sceptical of him being in the title hunt again this year, but if nothing else, Mansell has always been the kind of driver who'd pick his car up and carry it across the line if necessary, which may be just what the team need this year. At any rate, he ought to be exciting to watch, even without the trademark moustache, which has disappeared during winter testing. Riccardo Patrese, signing as Williams' first ever Italian driver, turned a few heads among pundits who thought his career was winding down after his unsuccessful spells at Alfa Romeo and Brabham. He often looked rather like he was just cruising for a paycheck rather than giving it his all, but in the teams he was in, that was probably all he could really do. In any case, car allowing, his signing for Williams will be his big chance to resurrect his career, if he can seize it. Zakspeed enter their fourth year in F1 with their fourth driver lineup. As many predicted, Martin Brundle has left, to drive sports cars for Tom Walkinshaw, and Piercarlo Ganzani comes in as the new team leader. In the other car, Christian Danner failed to agree terms, and is also replaced by fellow countryman and rookie Bernd Schneider. They'll be driving the Zakspeed 881, a development of the unsuccessful 871, and few expect much of an improvement as the team get one more year out of their home-brewed turbo engine. On paper, it's only about 10 horsepower short of the mighty Honda, and about on par with the Megatrons, but the car is also some 20 kilos, 1,230 pounds, heavier than the top teams, which is probably a major reason why it doesn't go anywhere near as fast as it ought to in theory. The indomitable Piercarlo must really love being a Grand Prix driver, opined Autosport magazine in their season preview. He certainly hasn't had a lot of luck with his cars during his career, with moves to Tolman and Ligier both coinciding with particular low points for those teams, and most of his career devoted to the perennial pauper's Ozella. With the best will in the world, this will probably not be the drive to set him on the path to greatness, but his patience, good humour and developmental skills should be good for the team. Hailing from near Saarbrücken, near the French border, young Bernd was born to a racing-mad family. He was named after pre-war great Bernd Rosemeyer, and was a German junior kart champion by just 15 years old in 1979. A year later, he won the world junior title. Then in 1981, he was third in the German senior Class A series. In 1982, European kart champion, and in 1983, African kart champion. Clearly, the boy could kart, but could he drive a car? Well, he moved into German Formula Ford for 1984 and was overall runner-up at the first attempt. The next year, he entered both German and European Formula Ford 2000, coming fourth and fifth respectively, and earning himself a move up to German F3, where he again made an immediate splash, coming third in his rookie year, before absolutely demolishing the opposition in 1987, winning 7 out of 8 races. By this time, Schneider was being touted as a star of the future, and although normally a driver would move up to F3000 as a stepping stone to F1, when Zakspeed offered him the chance to skip that step and go straight in, few doubted he'd be up to it. Whether Zakspeed will be able to give him the car he deserves is another matter entirely, of course. With the unfamiliar numbers 11 and 12 on their noses, McLaren are preparing for their first season with a new-look team. Ron Dennis and co. are optimistic, adding the proven quality of the Honda engine and Ayrton Senna to the team's successful pedigree of design and Alain Prost driving talent, but there are a lot of new elements that need to gel well together to get the best out of the package. The new chassis, the MP44, is again drawn by Steve Nichols, with input from technical director Gordon Murray, and was one of the few all-new cars on the grid, rather than an evolution of the previous one. However, it continues the trend, begun by Murray, of very low-lying cars, helped by the smaller fuel tanks and lower profile of the Honda engine compared to last year's Tags. Prost had a fairly ordinary 1987 by his own high standards, with two early wins cancelled out by the reliability problems that the Tag engine developed as a result of the new fuel and pop-off valve regulations. He'd had a couple of years now as an undisputed team number one, but shouldn't be too rattled by the arrival of the talented Senna in the other car. After all, he gave the legendary Niki Lauda a good race, and now it's his turn to be the multi-title winning established star against the young upstart. This young man has impressed ever since coming into the sport in 1984, and many suspect that he's made the Lotus of the last couple of years look much better than it actually was. Assuming that all the elements come together for McLaren this year, this latest move could be the one to bring him the consistent wins and title he deserves, but his main challenge will be his new teammate. Clive James joked in 1986 that even the Portaloo at Lotus was set up for Senna, so it might be difficult for him to adjust to being equal or even number two.